अस्सलाम वालेकुम क्लास, दिस इज माय फर्स्ट फॉर्मल लेक्चर टू यू आफ्टर द इंट्रोडक्टरी क्लास. यू हैव ऑलरेडी कवर्ड फ्यू ऑफ द इम्पॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ द सब्जेक्ट व्हिच इंक्लूड द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ प्राइमरी हेल्थ केयर एंड इट्स डिटरमिनेंट्स एंड इट्स एसेंशियल प्रिंसिपल्स एंड हाउ इट वर्क्स. यू हैव कवर्ड द इंटरनेशनल हेल्थ एजेंसीज व्हिच आर वर्किंग इंटरनेशनली फॉर अटेनमेंट ऑफ हेल्थ एट इंटरनेशनल कम्युनिटी लेवल्स. You have already covered the health system of Pakistan, and today in this lecture we will be discussing that what are different determinants of health. So before going into the details of the determinants of health, we will be discussing that how WHO defines health and disease, what is the spectrum of disease, what are different determinants of health, and what are different theories which are displayed for the disease causation by the World Health Organization and which are worldwidely accepted by different epidemiologists. So starting with the first objective, how will we define health? WHO has given a very comprehensive definition of health. It says that it's a complete state of physical, mental and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. And let me talk about the definition of health. The concept which is given by the WHO is that as community medicine people or as public health consultants, we are not only concerned with the physical aspects of the health, but we are also concerned with the mental health and the social health of a person. It means that we want to target that the person should be physically fit, he should be emotionally and mentally stable, and he should lead a socially productive life. So according to the definition of World Health Organization, if a person is physically fit and mentally fit and he is leading an economic and socially productive life, he is defined as a healthy person. But health is health cannot be counted in terms when the epidemiologist wants to measure the health status of communities, because it is difficult to define a healthy person and then counting them. So the health is basically measured in terms of four other parameters, which include disease, injury, disability, and death. So if you want to present the death, if you want to present the health status of a community, you want to talk about the in terms of the presence of disease, that what is the percentage of the diseased population in that community, what is the percentage of the injured population in that country, or are there any disabled population available in that country, and if they are disabled, are they physically disabled, or are they mentally disabled, or are they socially disabled. And then we also talk about the health status of a community in terms of the numbers of deaths which are occurring in that community. So in a nutshell, I would like to say that health is not measured in terms of health when we talk about as a public health perspective. We talk about health in terms of presence of disease, injury, disability, and death. And we deal with the statistics of these four parameters to show the health status of a country or a community. In ideal circumstances, we assume that a newborn will be born when the when all the structures are present in morphologically best form, and they are working in optimum functional capacity, and the person or the newborn baby is in full health. And as the age advances, his health is maintained until and unless he reaches an adulthood. And with advancing age from the adulthood, the health starts declining and the probability of death gets increased in time. But with the knowledge of science and technology, we know that this occurs in the ideal circumstances, but in normal routine circumstances, we get certain individuals who are malformed, who are structurally malformed even at birth. They show chromosomal abnormalities, they show inborn errors of metabolism, they show different types of genetic diseases, and there is no age or there is no time which is free of the disease. For example, in case of childhood diseases, we have all the infectious diseases which can cause mortality. For example, the acute diarrheal disease, pneumonias, measles, mumps, rubella, tuberculosis, and infectious diseases can be encountered in the childhood. And then in adolescent age group, we can encounter multiple mental health issues and social health issues. The multiple perverted behaviors are observed in the adolescent age when they are coping with the society. And there are different cancers and different adulthood problems which can be encountered even in the adulthood. So the ideal circumstances in which we assumed that when a baby is born, he enjoys the full health. And with advancing age, the probability of getting the disease and death increases, does not occur. And the disease and death can occur in any of the times during lifetime. So when we talk about the disease can be defined in three form of terminologies, which include the disease, illness, and sickness. All the three have different meanings, and they are measured in different forms. For example, disease is defined as a physiological or psychological dysfunction. If there is physiological dysfunction, then it means definitely the physical health is affected. Or if there is psychological dysfunction, definitely the mental health is affected. And so a disease is defined as a physiological or psychological dysfunction. Dysfunction of some organ or dysfunction an organ, dysfunction of a system is defined as a disease. And then we move towards the illness. Illness is a subjective state of the person in which the one person feels that and he's aware that I'm not being well. And he himself feels that I'm sick, I'm not well. And this is the subjective feeling of one person about his or her own self. Sickness is defined as a state of social dysfunction. It means that the person is unable to perform that social role because of his illness, which was his responsibility. So we actually define these three terms in three different perspectives. Disease in terms of dysfunction. Illness is a state in which the one person feels that I am not well. And sickness is inability to perform the social function because of the illness. So these are the three different concepts when we talk about the disease causation. Whenever we talk about the disease causation, there is a stage of susceptibility in which a person has the susceptibility to get the infection or to get the disease. When a person or a community is prone to get the infection, and then exposure occurs. After the exposure, there is stage in which the pathological changes occur, which is known as stage of subclinical disease. This is the stage in which the sign and symptoms are not suggestive of that acute clinical conditions with which the patient present himself with the sign and symptoms. And actually, there are only prodromal sign and symptoms or inapparent sign and symptoms which do not point out towards the stage of clinical disease. Moving further, after the pathological changes, the onset of symptoms occur, and this is the stage of clinical disease in which the apparent sign and symptoms obviously indicate that this particular person has this particular disease. And at this time, usually the time of diagnosis occurs, because at this stage, the patient goes to the doctor, and the doctor, on the basis of sign and symptoms, diagnose a certain condition. After passing through this stage, the stage comes in which either the recovery will occur, or the disability will occur, or the death will occur. So this is the normal continuum of the occurrence of the disease, in which one person moves from the stage of susceptibility to the stage of subclinical infection and to the stage of clinical disease. And after that, either the recovery occurs or the disability or death occurs. So when we talk about the continuum or the spectrum from health to death, it shows the different phases. For example, on one end, there is perfect health, and on the other end, there is death. And in between, there are different zones which are merged with each other. For example, perfect health is followed by moderate health and then the marginal health. Here, the exposure of risk or the lifestyle occurs and the early disease causation takes place, which is followed by the late disease and which then ultimately follows to the death. This is the continuation from health to death. Sometimes the person moves from health to disease, and then from when he recovers, he goes back from disease to the health condition. So the people can show transition between different states of health and disease, and this is known for the infectious diseases. This is also known as the gradient of infection. So when we talk about the spectrum of disease from health to death, we have different preventive measures which can be applied. For example, when a person is living in the condition of moderate health or marginal health, we can apply the level of prevention, which is known as health promotion. In health promotion, health education messages are given to promote the health, different adaptive techniques to better health, and important lifestyle modifications are adjusted, different health education messages are given. And then when the person moves to the exposure, in primary prevention, along with the health education, we give specific protection. For example, if a person is exposed to hepatitis B virus, for example, if a doctor is working in a hospital in which he is exposed to the needle injury and he's exposed to the hepatitis B virus, then the specific protective measures are given, in which hepatitis B immunoglobulins are given and hepatitis B vaccinations are given. And then in phase in which there is a disease displays itself with the different clinical sign and symptoms, we can early diagnose the disease and we can treat it. In the later phase, we can do specific certain preventive measures to reduce the disability which is associated with the disease, and we can give the rehabilitative services, which is known as the tertiary prevention. So different types of preventive services can be offered throughout the spectrum of health, from from health to disease. When we talk about the spectrum of disease, there are certain conditions which can exhibit them ideally in the spectrum of disease. For example, when we talk about the polio, 95% cases are basically lying in this zone, which are known as subclinical zone, in which they do not exhibit the sign and symptoms. Only 4% show the flu-like symptom, and only 1% show the paralysis. Another example can be that tuberculosis, leprosy, other infectious diseases can show themselves along the spectrum of disease, passing in which the patient passes from different stages of health to disease and disability before the death. But there is one infectious disease which never shows the spectrum of disease in a full continuum. This is known as rabies, because it starts with the smaller incubation period and ends with death. There is no recovery and there is no going back towards the healthy condition. So this is the only one disease which does not exhibit the whole stages of the spectrum of disease. Moving forward, we will be talking about the determinants of health. There are multiple factors which are important for the determinant, which are acting as the important factors for as the determinants of health. Health is basically defined as the basic concept, basic right of the individuals. And this is not only the responsibility of the individual to maintain the health, but the families, communities, societies work together in association with the state and international agencies to maintain the health of the communities. So there are multiple factors. We will be discussing them one by one. For example, there are multiple biological factors which are related to the genes. And we all know that there are multiple diseases which are related to the internal genetic structure, which predispose to the causation of disease. For example, the BRCA gene is associated with the development of the breast cancer. For example, there are multiple genetic disorders For example, Klinefelter syndrome, Down syndrome, multiple inborn errors of metabolism exist because of the genetic malformations. So this basically depends upon the genetic structure. We have different behavioral patterns which can lead to disease. For example, smoking, drug abuse, and for example, sedentary lifestyles, which can lead to obesity, which then further leads to the development of coronary heart disease and stroke, etc. So multiple behavioral factors can lead towards the disease causation. Then there are environmental factors, the microenvironment and the macroenvironment. The microenvironment is the domestic environment, which encompasses the indoor air pollution, the psychological environment, the social environment, the domestic environment. And then there is macroenvironment, which encompasses the air pollution, soil pollution, water pollution, noise pollution, etc. As you all know that Lahore and Delhi has been declared as the most dangerous cities to live because of the poor quality of air index. So that constitutes the major threat to the health status of the communities there. So environment plays an important role. Then the socioeconomic status, and the socioeconomic status not only contains the poverty, which can affect the health status, but it also is related to the education. It is related to the economic conditions. We all know that those countries in which there is lower socioeconomic group, the non-communicable diseases are much more prevalent. And in developed countries, the non-communicable diseases are much more prevalent. So the socioeconomic conditions affect the health status. Health system, the presence of health system affect the health status. For example, if a country has better diagnostic facilities and treatment and preventive and curative services, definitely the health of the population will be much better than in the resource-constrained countries where the health system only provides the diagnostic and treatment facilities. So further determinants can include the socio-cultural factors. For example, there are beliefs about health status. For example, there are certain social and cultural issues. For example, religion. In religion, the Muslims go for circumcision, but the Hindus do not go for circumcision, and this circumcision prevents the penile cancer. For example, in Pakistani setup, many women tend to breastfeed their children, which can reduce the chances of getting breast cancer. And then there are multiple other factors. For example, in Pakistani population, there is tendency to give khutti to the newborn baby, which can cause acute diarrheal disease, etc., etc. So socio-cultural environment also affect the health status. As the population age, and there is a much more tendency of having geriatric population in a country, the health status of the country is affected, because this particular population, the geriatric population, is not only affected by the physical health, but also with the mental and social health challenges. We can see that in those European countries where the geriatric population was much more evident, in which the population was more than 65 years of age, they suffered with the high mortality rates with COVID-19 as compared to the population in which the younger population was much more evident. With the presence of science and technology, and new modalities are formulated for diagnosis and treatment, and these new modalities help us to control the concept of health and disease. Then information and communication. We all know the health education messages can alter the health status, and we have seen it in COVID-19 that the WHO declared many health education messages in which they promoted the use of masks and also the use of sanitizers. And this information was conveyed digitally to the whole world. So it has altered the pattern of disease worldwide. So gender also affects the health status. For example, there are certain conditions which are much more common in females, and there are certain conditions which are much more common in males. For example, the lungs cancer is much more evident in male population as compared to the breast cancer, which is much more common in the female population. Then equity and social justice. Equity means the resources are targeted towards the area where they are needed. For example, when we talk about the health service care provision, we say that the health should be provided to all the people, irrespective of their age and gender. It means we are talking about the concept of equality. But in resource-constrained countries, we say that all those who need healthcare service provision in much more capacity as compared to the other, they should be given emphasis. For example, we talk about the situation of immunization of COVID-19 in resource-constrained countries. When we have limited immunization facility, we are targeting the healthcare providers first and then the aged population. But I will say that it is a human right to have a healthy population. To have healthy perspective and to have health. And there are multiple determinants of health which play interactive role to produce disease in at the individual level and at the communities level. So talking about the multiple factors which cause the disease, we should move forward with the concept of causation. There are multiple theories which have been given by different epidemiologists to tell about how the disease is being caused. Initially, before the era of causation of disease and the theories were presented, it was thought that the disease is caused by the when the God wants to give punishment to the people, or when there was magic in the air, or there was something bad with the air or water, it caused the disease. But the revolutionary changes came with the emergence of the germ theory, when the Louis Pasteur said that there are multiple microorganisms which are present in the environment. When they enter in the body of the host, they can cause the disease. And he gave the concept of germ theory. So, germ theory says that the agent should be present, and when it interacts with the man, it causes the disease. And in the absence of an infectious agent, the disease cannot be caused. And this agent can be any virus or bacteria or fungus or algae or any parasite which can enter into the body and can alter the system of the human being, which can cause the disease. This makes the basis of the germ theory. But another theory was brought into the picture by the epidemiologists, which say that it is not only the presence of the agent and the host to cause the disease, but the environment should also be appropriate. For example, whenever the Mycobacterium tuberculosis is present in the body of the human being, it is not necessary that it produces the disease every time. So there is a certain condition of the environment which affects the disease causation, and there are certain factors in the environment which stimulate the causation of the disease. So it gives a concept that three important factors help in the disease causation, and these are agent, host, and environment. Moving towards the agent factors and the host interaction in the environment, it was again thought that there is another factor, which is time, which alters the behavior of the disease. So the modern concept of epidemiological triad brings the time in the center, and it says that during the interaction of agent, host, and environment, time plays a key role for the disease causation. Then this is the advanced model, which keeps the time, and it says that the causative factors, when enter into the population, there are certain characteristics of the population and the individuals which affect the disease causation. And then there is environment, which is modified by the behaviors, cultures, myths, and customs. In the presence of time elapsed, which is required for the disease causation, disease is caused in by the complex interaction of these three factors. So the agent factors, there are multiple agent factors. For example, and when we talk about the biological agent factors, there may be viruses, bacteria, fungus, algae, and parasitic infections, which can cause the disease. Then the agent factors can be nutritional factors. For example, the presence of certain factors can cause certain diseases, and their absence can cause certain diseases. For example, if there is a deficiency of vitamin C, it can lead to scurvy. If there is deficiency of iodine, it can lead to goiter. If there is excess of carbohydrates and fat, it can lead to the hypercholesterolemia and coronary heart disease. If there is excess of salt intake, it can cause to hypertension. So multiple nutritional factors can also play a role of being an agent factor in the epidemiological triad. Then there may be physical factors. The physical factors include the physical factors in the environment. For example, the excess of temperature, the cold temperature, the presence of radiations in the environment, vibrations in the environment, noise, for example, the presence of x-rays, for example, the light. So these are multiple factors which can cause disease causation. For example, if there is excessive light, it can cause premature cataract. If there is excessive vibration, it can cause white finger syndrome. If there is a low temperature, it can cause the trench foot and frostbite. If there is high temperature, it can cause heat hyperpyrexia and heat stroke. So these are the agent factors which are classified under the heading of the physical agent. Then we have different chemicals which are present in the environment. For example, we have heard about the lead poisoning, arsenic poisoning, carbon monoxide poisoning, hydrogen sulfide poisoning, which can be present in the form in the air, or they can be present in the water, or they can be ingested, and they can produce different signs and symptoms. Then there can be mechanical factors, and as we all know that with the industrialization, people are actually dealing with machines, and these machines can cause mechanical injury. They can cause loss of limbs. Sometimes the people who are working in industries, they can have physical disability because of this mechanical hazards and the mechanical agents which are involved. And so they can be different types of factors which can help in disease causation. And then with the social, there are social factors. For example, there is peer pressure which can cause mental health problems. There are social pressures, the chances and the emotional factors which are related to the working environment or the school environment or the domestic environment. They can also affect the not only the mental health but also the physical health. So there are multiple types of agent factors which can cause disease. When we talk about the host factors, we know that the age and gender of the population can affect the health. For example, there are certain diseases which are much more common in female population, and there are certain diseases which are common in male population. There are certain diseases which are common in the childhood, and there are certain diseases which are common in the geriatric population. So age and gender distribution affect the disease causation in when we talk about the host factors. Then we have the different genetic materials which are present in the host factors, and the exposure to multiple risk factors, exposure to multiple biological agents. And for example, in case of other than genetic diseases, the immunity is present as a one of the biological factor. In the case of host factors, we have nutritional status of the host factor which can cause the disease causation. Then we have social and economic factors of the host which can help in the disease causation. As we have already discussed, with the higher upper socioeconomic group, you have non-communicable diseases. With the lower socioeconomic group, you have communicable diseases. You have social pressures in the teenage, and you encounter multiple emotional traumas and social pressures which can cause the disease causation as well. And then when we talk about the host factor, the lifestyle modifications can also be related to the disease causation of multiple diseases. For example, if somebody is smoking, or they are taking drugs, or they are more prone to take stresses, they can cause multiple type of diseases. So the third factor in the epidemiological triad is the environmental factor. And again, the environment is divided into three types. The physical environment, which contains the physical factors, for example, the air pollution, noise pollution, soil pollution, the radiation exposure, vibration exposure, etc. The biological environment means the interaction with the other biological agents, in which the human-to-human interaction, human-to-animals interaction, and the interaction with the infectious agents, which include the viruses and bacteria, can be encountered. And then there is psychosocial environment, which can produce the mental health issues and the psychological issues as well. And we have discussed that the environment can be further subdivided into microenvironment and the macroenvironment. So this was all related to the disease causation because of the epidemiological triad. Another concept of disease causation is known as wheel of causation, which says that the host factors are basically the genetic core which affects the disease causation, and then the genetic core is basically surrounded by the environment, and this environment is the social, physical, and biological environment. And by the complex interaction of these three types of environment with the genetic core, disease is caused. And this concept is known as wheel of causation, where the center of the wheel is consists of genetic core, and the outer zone of the wheel is caused by the environment. Another theory which causes the disease is known as web of causation, which it says that there is not only one factor which is related to the disease causation in human beings, but there are multiple factors which are actually essential for the disease causation, and they are interrelated to each other. And when they are interrelated to each other, they cause the web of causation. For example, lung cancer can be caused by smoking alone. It can be caused by environmental pollution alone. It can be caused by occupational exposure alone. It can be caused by the hereditary factors, but they all interact with each other and form a complex web. For example, if somebody is working in an environment in which he is occupationally exposed and he is also smoking, the effect will be multiplied for the causation of the lung cancer. So when they interact with each other, this is known as web of causation. Another example of web of causation can be explained that how heart disease or stroke can be caused. They can be caused by multiple factors, again, which are interrelated. For example, it is the main causative factor is obesity and smoking. And they are then further aggravated by multiple factors. For example, if somebody is not involved in physical activity, it can cause to obesity. If somebody is taking extra diet and not taking physical diet, diet can also cause obesity. And if it is not doing physical activity, it can further aggravate the obesity. There are certain people who are who eat more in stress and gain weight. And then there are certain hormones which play important role in the development of obesity. Sometimes smoking and obesity coexist. So there are multiple factors which can lead to the development of the atherosclerosis. And this atherosclerosis can lead to stroke and heart diseases, or even hypertension. So multiple complex interaction of multiple factors with each other disease causing one disease is known as web of causation. Another example of web of causation, for the myocardial infarction, you can see that multiple factors are playing their role and they are interlinked with each other. And why it is known as web of causation? Because they are interlinked with each other. So moving towards the natural history of disease, it says that from the disease of pre-pathogenesis or the stage of susceptibility, there is a complex interaction of agent, host, and environment. And then the disease occurs with the development of signs and symptoms. The disease can progress to illness and disability and defect. It can go towards the chronic state, or it can go towards death, or it can go towards the recovery. And different types of levels of prevention are applied at each step. When we talk about the disease status, it is explained by the iceberg phenomena of a disease, which says that as the iceberg shows only the tip above the ocean, the diagnosed cases are very few which comes to the attention of a doctor. But a large submerged portion, which is undiagnosed cases, which are pre-symptomatic cases or latent cases, they do not come into the attention of the doctors. And many of the diseases exhibit this phenomena, in which they do not show the apparent signs and symptoms. And many of the
carriers or undiagnosed cases remain in the community, which can transmit infection from one person to another person. So this iceberg phenomena indicates that the primary healthcare physicians or the public health consultants should focus on this undiagnosed or area much more than the diagnosed disease. This undiagnosed disease can be pre-symptomatic cases in which the signs and symptoms have not yet apparent. Make themselves apparent. There may be cases in which the infectious agent is present, but it is present in the latent phase, and in a subsequent time period it will exhibit the signs and symptoms. It can be shown by the inapparent cases in which the signs and symptoms are not suggestive of disease, and the person present himself only with the myalgias and fever and not suggestive signs and symptoms. And then there are carriers who actually do not show any sign and symptom, but they are susceptible of transmitting the infection from one person to another person. So the iceberg phenomena of the disease shows that as public health consultants, we are much more concerned with the submerged portion of the iceberg rather than the tip of the iceberg. So with this, I will end my lecture today. And if you have any questions, you can directly contact me through WhatsApp group or through the Facebook group. I will be answering your questions, and I'm not giving you assignment today. So hopefully, see you soon. Thank you.